Welcome guys to this online presentation. Today we will speak about MATLAB used on AWS, Amazon Web Service. We, as a Polytechnic of Milano student, have some free use of AWS, and so we want to show you how to use it with MATLAB. So let's start. A little, a brief introduction on us, for those of you that doesn't know. We are the connection between you, so students of Politecnico, and MATLABs. So we organize events like this one online because of the current situation, and we manage the community on Facebook. Today's agenda, we start from why use AWS, how to register a student account, how to instantiate a virtual machine, and finally some case study that could exploit the potentiality of Amazon Web Service. Now, why AWS? Amazon Web Service is a cloud computing service, so you have your local PC, you connect to internet, and the internet, of course, make it possible to connect to Amazon servers. This connection in both ways make it possible to use the potentiality of this powerful server for our purpose. MATLAB on AWS is particularly suitable because we know that some applications for MATLAB are very time consuming, are very complex, use lots of memory. And so for the people that has not at their home a high powerful computer, or that want to perform a specific calculus that requires a lot of computation, they can use this service without buying a specific machine for only this use. In particular, as we will see, MATLAB on a web service, Amazon Web Service, is on demand, so you don't need to buy anything, but you pay as you use it, and is very scalable. You can select the machine or the machines, because you can create also a cloud of machine based on the performance you need in that specific task. For example, could be training a neural network, simulating of a very complex environment, physics, and so on. So why use Amazon Web Service? The traditional way, when we have an high complex calculation, is to buy a server. So normally a company that need to perform high complex calculus buy a server or a rack of server. The alternative is to subscribe to Amazon Web Service. Of course, buy a server is very expensive. You have to pay a lot one time. Subscribe to AWS is a paid subscription, but you pay as you use the service. So the initial investment is different, of course. Once we set up the server or the virtual machine, we can perform our computation. The difference is that if I need this server, this machine, only for one single calculus, if I buy a server, I, of course, now have a server that is unused. Whereas if I subscribe to Amazon Web Service, I can simply switch off the virtual machine and I paid only the time that I use effectively it. So it depends from how many calculus we need to perform. So what's inside the Amazon Web Service? Because Amazon Web Service, like the world's state, it is a rack, it is a group of different services that Amazon put online. For example, EFS, S3, EC2. So different type of server and computation machine. Specifically, each of these one are specific for some task. So let's do a little bit of clustering of these different solutions. Let's make it easier. So Amazon Web Service contains computing machine, storage machine, other type of machine. So now for this moment, we select only computing. Computing contains a lot of different type of machine. So CPU oriented, memory oriented, GPU oriented. So in particular, if you need one specific task, you can select the best machine that suits your task. In our case, we select CPU-oriented because it is the one that we want to show you today. CPU oriented, of course, have a different type of machine, classified based on their performance, their RAM, their processor, and so on. Here you can see the different type that you can use with your free subscription. In particular, the M5 2X Large is the most powerful virtual machine that you can use for free with your student subscription. Of course, there are lots of other and more powerful machines, but we cannot use them without paying. So that's the one that we will use today. But of course, the concept is not different. If you want to use a more powerful machine, you can simply pay and follow the same step that we will show you in a moment, and the result will be the same. So AWS is the service. EC2 are the family of AWS instance that are the one that we will use today. And in particular, the machine that we will use is the M5 2X Large. In particular, it has 8 virtual CPU, 32 gigabyte of RAM, and up to 10 gigabit per second of connection. Without the student subscription, you need to pay 38 cents per hour to use it, but it's not our case. So now it's time to open your account of Amazon Web Service. So you have to go to AWS Educate and register with your Polymy credential, so in particular your email account, to be able to subscribe to this particular offer. So let's see in practice how to enter your Amazon Web Service account and start your machine. As you can see, I'm already logged in AWS Educate. I can simply select Amazon Web Service account and click on AWS Educate Starter Account. Clicking on it, I will enter the section of AWS that is allowed for students. Here, I can have some Q&A about how I can use my machine. And here I have that my credit is $96 and I have 2 hours and 60 minutes of time. Now I click on AWS console and I enter the AWS machine directly. Okay, here we are. As you can see, here is only an home screen of Amazon AWS. I can click on Service and on EC2, that are the machine that we want to use. Now, in this left bar, you can see different menus. Our interest is instances that collect all of the already existing instances that you have created. As you can see here, I have already created an M5 2X Large that is actually running in this moment, but we want to create with you a new machine in order to show you how to do it. So you have to go there in Launch Instances. As you can see, the machine that are free for you as students, are the ones that has this little badge on the bottom. In our case, we want to select Windows because we want to install MATLAB on Windows. So we select Windows. Now he asks us what type of machine, which type of machine we want to use. As you can see here, there are lots of machines that actually we cannot use all of them. So we select our M5. In order to search for it, you can order it by name. So we go down to M, okay, here, and we select the M5 2X Large, that is this one, okay. So as you can see, 8 core, 32 gigabytes of memory, and 10 gigabit of connection. So now we can go to review and launch, that will give us a recap on how we can, on what machine we selected, what operating system we selected, and so on. So now we can simply hit launch. Launch, we can, this is a key fundamental step because you need a key on a file that is your key that each time you will open up your machine, you can select in order to decrypt your password. So what does it mean? I have already a key, but of course, we want to create another one. So you have to select create a new key pair, enter a name, for example, MATLAB, Italy, and you simply download the key pair. You have to save this file in a safe place because you cannot download it anymore from now on, because it's your private key. Now you launch the instances and you wait. Okay, perfect. Your instance is now launching, so our machine is starting, and we can click view instances in order to see what instances we have. So as you can see, the first one is the one that I have before, and the second one is pending because it's actually starting up. So let's see how to actually see your virtual desktop on your computer. So what you can do is, first of all, now as you can see, also the second machine is running, is in the selection. Okay, so what we can do? First of all, now the machine is already running, but in the case is switched off, you can simply go to Action, Instance State, and start up the machine. Remember that we have a limited credit for Amazon Web Service. So if you forget to switch off your machine, you continually scale your credit. So you are actually paying with this credit. So remember that when you finish to use the machine, remember to switch it off in order to avoid this problem. For example, I want to connect to the first machine. So it is running. So this is a requirement, of course. I can click connect. Here, I can select the method. I can let standalone RDP client. As you can see here, I have the username administrator, but the password is not clear. How can I see the password? I have to use the previous file that I showed you before, the key. So I click get password. I select my key pair. So in this case, I have it here. This private key can decrypt my password. So I decrypt the password. Perfect. And now the password is clear, this one. I have to copy it on the clipboard. Once I done it, I download the remote desktop file that is simply a link with all of the configuration file that you need for your desktop. I click it. We have downloaded the file, so we are ready to start our virtual machine. But let's see a quick recap on what we have done in order for you to have a documentation about it. So we select the EC2 console. We create the key, we launch the instance of a Microsoft Windows Server with M5 2X large, and we launch this machine, we start up the machine. Now we have the key pair, the virtual machine instance, and we want to connect to the virtual machine and install MATLAB. So the last step are the open the instance on Amazon Web Service, select machine, click connect, decrypt your password with the key pair, as I shown you one moment ago, and launch the remote desktop. Now, let's see this last part. As you can see, with Windows, you have already Windows Remote Desktop. For Mac, you need to install it. And for Linux, we can use Remina. Particularly interesting for Linux Ubuntu users, because, for example, if you have if you want to use MATLAB on Windows without actually installing the virtual machine on your actual machine, you can actually use this virtual remote desktop. So let's see, starting from here, we have downloaded the remote desktop file. We can double click on it, this file, AC2, etc. So as you can see, we have our machine started up. It is a Windows 10 machine, and you can install and work on whatever you want. So now let's see how to do this this procedure on Ubuntu. You can simply disconnect. So we are now on Ubuntu. We have to install Remina, that is this virtual desktop client. Here you can see Remina menu. Opening my window, now we have to setting up a preference that is fundamental. In fact, this is our file that I have downloaded and added on Remina. You need to go there in edit and make sure that this color depth is set on high color 16 bpp, because otherwise if you select this other option, the deep color compatibility give an issue that is not possible to connect to the machine. So we can save this and connect. We simply insert the same password than before. We click OK and we wait. As you can see, we are now connected on Ubuntu on your virtual machine. You can simply go in full window, and here we have the same virtual machine than before, but it is running on Ubuntu. So now we disconnect. Okay, perfect. And we can return to our slides. So we have seen how to do this procedure on macOS, on Linux. Now Alberto, my colleague, will show you how to do this on desktop, on Windows desktop, and in particular how to install MATLAB and proceed with the case study that we want to show you today. So I give the word to my colleague Alberto.
Thank you, Daniele, and now let's see how to install MATLAB on our virtual machine. Okay, first of all, let's do a little overview on what are the steps that we have to follow in order to install MATLAB. First of all, we suggest you to download Google Chrome in order to have a better experience to download the software, and also because there are some issues between the MathWorks side and the older version of Internet Explorer. So, second of all, we have to go on the MathWorks side, then log in with your credential and download your latest version of MATLAB. Of course, you have then to proceed as normal, because you now have to consider this as your personal computer. So let's see how to do it. First of all, we suggest you to disable a security alert in the Windows Explorer. Why it's important? Because we want to avoid that each time we open a new site, it asks for permission. So you have to select here in the window, Start, Server Manager. Once you are inside, Local Server, and then you have to search for IE and change the security configuration. This is important to disable it, so we can now open the web browser without any permission. So we have done it, we close, we open Internet Explorer, we simply search for Google, now Chrome. We can now install Chrome easily. Download Chrome. I have already installed it, but by the way, it's simple. We simply follow the steps, and we can now open Google Chrome. With Google Chrome, we can go, as I said before, in the MathWorks site, MathWorks, then go inside our sign in in our MathWorks account, as usual. So okay, password. Okay, we are inside. We select our license, we click download, and we download the latest release. Now, I have to give you some suggestions and some tips about the installation. First of all, when we proceed for the installation of MATLAB, as you know, you can select different toolboxes. Keep in mind that, as I can show you now, our virtual machine has a limited space of hard drive, so 30 gigs of hard drive. So, to avoid, let's say, overcharge this SSD, it's better to select only the plugin you need for your installation. So, let's suppose that you want only MATLAB, as clear as possible, select only MATLAB. You want Simulink, select Simulink. Of course, you can decide your best toolbox, but for sure you cannot install all of them. So, now, let's go back to our presentation. In our presentation, let's do a recap. First of all, we have our remote desktop, we have prepared our AWS with MATLAB, and we have connected it as Daniele showed you. So, by the way, let's say that this is really, it's simple. So, at the beginning of this presentation, you were a little bit confusing on how to do all these steps, but now we have give you a clear path in order to install MATLAB. Now I want to show you the potentiality of this machine. First of all, we have to decide some case study. In order to do this, we select some application that can scale well on a multi-core processor, and also some application that are related to what is currently happening in the world. So we wisely choose infection simulator. In particular, how this simulator works. We have a parameter of the population. We give inside this parameter of the population, so we decide how the population behave, into let's say an engine that analyze, do some computation, and at the end compute the interaction between the different organisms inside this population. After all, what we get as output, a prevision. So we decide to use two simulators. The first one, only with MATLAB, that is a simple simulator developed by Clive, and you can find it on the link you can read on the right side. The second simulator is a little bit more complex, and also take into account the recovered after the ill. Okay, and again, you can find it on the MathWorks site. By the way, I suggest you to keep an eye on MathWorks site, because sometimes happen to be there some interesting new project that can be also very useful for your school or business. So this is our simulator by Clive. First of all, we have here a list of parameters that we can give as input to our simulator. Our simulator then will compute and elaborate all the different information and give as output the graph that you can see on the right. So you can see how the interaction, the infection goes, how is important to keep safe distance between the different person, and then the last is how long will take all the infection to reach the peak, and so reach all the different people inside the community. Okay, let's see practically on MATLAB how to launch the first simulator. We simply double click on the MATLAB logo, it will open. By the way, you can see that it is quite fast. And then we can hit the COVID, we can first of all give a rapid look on the code. Again, we have here the parameters, as you can see, the number of population sites and the initial infection fraction, the static fraction, and so on. I'm not an expert of this type of simulator, but what I can the important thing is that this simulator performs well also on this type of machine. And if you want to scale up the number of the population, you can easily see that it will perform well also with a big number. So we in the command window down here, we can run this by writing COVID-19, and it launched our application that, by the way, have also this beautiful interface. So we can see that now we have the infection that is proceeding. So we can, in the bottom here, see which number of iteration is currently doing. So we can pause this. We can augment the number of, let's say, of individuals. Let's say we start from 50, we go up to, I don't know what you want. This simulator is very, very efficient. So we put 400, we click start. And again, you can see that it is a little bit slower, but it continues to evolve. So as you can see, we have a good performance also on this virtual machine. And I know that this simulator is quite fast, but with the second example, I will show you that not all the simulators are so fast. So, by the way, this is the simulator. Let's move back on the slide and discuss about the second simulator. So now let's see the second simulator. This time the simulator has a little bit a different behavior. First of all, as you can see in the slide, we have on the top corner the interaction between the different particles that simulate the population. And below it, we can see the Gaussian form. So how the expansion goes displayed in a different form. Again, as input of the simulator, we give the population, the initial infection fraction, and so on, and this simulator computes the interaction. Of course, this simulator is a little bit different from the previous one, because, as we can see, we have the parameters here that we have just see and we select. We give it into the population, and as you can see here, each P represents a different person, and this person interacts with the other one, giving us the result as I show you in the overall scheme of a simulator. So parameters, engine, and then the result. But how a person behaves in this type of simulator? A person can have three states: health, heal, or recovered. So let's say a healthy person that interacts with another health person, no problem. If a health person interacts with a heal person, it will become a heal also. And then it can evolve interaction by interaction in order to see that all the population became recovered or health. So we can now move on MATLAB and see how this simulator behaves. First of all, we have our simulator. The runme file shows us that there is an initialization data, okay, a tick-tock function that shows us how long it will take the simulation to run, and then the animate sim, so the animation of the simulation. First of all, let's work with the initialization data. As you can see here, there's the first part, okay, that show how many points we want to simulate. So each point will simulate a person. So we have 10 and 5 for a total of 50 person. Okay, at this point we can decide the dimension of the box, the radius of each ball, and so on and so forth, in order to define all the parameters. At this point, we can hit run, and we can load in our workspace all the variable. Okay, now, as we can see here, those are all the variables loaded. We can now go for the run me and click run. First of all, remember that our first try will take a little bit longer time because it will take the simulation up and running. So it has to run Simulink and then to load all the parameters. Okay, by the way, it takes 14 seconds and this is our simulator. So as you can see, the time is running. The interaction is, again, you can see the interaction and this is the curve. The Gaussian curve of the interaction and the expansion of the virus. Okay, it will take a little bit to show us all the results. Okay, we set an overall time of, as we can see, okay, it takes about 75 seconds. Okay, but we have computed all the interaction. Now, before joking a little bit with the parameters of the initialization, let's give a look to the Simulink file. Again, as you can see, I simply open Simulink also on the virtual machine, so there's any problem at all with this type of use. Here there's the curling simulator, so how the different simulation of the person will work. So it's a finite state machine in a state flow. Okay, here we have a sequence of function, a MATLAB function that will be used by the state flow itself in order to compute like the interaction between one person and the other one, also with the different combination of heal or recovered or healthy people, and so on and so forth. So as you can see here, there's the function of the interaction. I strongly suggest you to give a look at this code because it's very interesting and also I don't want to say complex, but it uses lots of different functions that can helpful for you in order to complete your mental scheme of what are the possibilities of this of Simulink. Okay, now the last thing I want to suggest you before doing the next test is to change here in this ball the value from 50 that was the default value to CNT, that is the variable that indicates the number of the overall people. Okay, now if we have done it, we can minimize the simulation and go joking a little bit with the data. We have now 50 people. We can go to 60 people. Okay, we change here 6. We run, we load again the parameters, and we hit run me. This time will take a little bit longer, of course, because we have augmented the number of the population. Again, we can see here it takes 8 seconds. Remember, what is the difference? Here has to start all the simulation. Here have to change the value in the simulation and run it again. So it did not have to open Simulink again. What we can do now is to stop this. Okay. Go initialization parameters and try changing the value, like let's put 10. So for a total of 100 points that simulate our population. We load this, we go to run me, and we run again the code. Okay, it's taking a little bit longer, of course. Okay, you can see here again that the animation is the same as before, so we can look at it. It's aggressive, so if you put a lot of points in this small area, it will have lots of interaction, so the aggressiveness or the aggressiveness of the curve, it's very very steep here. And then when he reached the top, also above this representation, then it starts the recovery and we go down. By the way, it is faster, definitely faster, it takes 52 seconds, but it have a peak that is higher than the previous example. Okay, now of course you can try changing this parameter as you wish. So you can try to augment the box, try to reduce the radio, or augment the speed of the balls, and so on and so forth. So if you want also to play a little bit with this simulator, it's up to you, and you can find it on the link I put in the slide some slide ago, or in the description. By the way, let's move back to the presentation and let's look at the result that I gave from this simulation. Result I get from this simulator. As you can see, starting with a population of 50, we use 6 gigs of RAM, and we go up, we take 7 seconds to compute the simulation. We go to 100 of a population of 100 people, and we get 7 gigs of RAM and 30 seconds, and so on. As you can see here, the time required to run the simulation is not linear. So what it means that if you want to compute a very big simulation with a lot of people, it would take a quite intensive use of RAM and a very long time of computation. And so what is the point with this slide is that if you want to run a simulation like this and you don't want to have your computer stuck in this simulation and you want to work meanwhile the simulation is running, I strongly suggest you to follow this course and to build and to run your virtual machine, so you can easily, as I just show you, run the code on the virtual machine once you have elaborate all your the stuff. You can copy and paste the results from the virtual machine to your local machine, and easily you can work with this type of system as you wish, with the computation you require. This time, in this example, is a long computation. Another example could be an intensive usage of RAM, and another example again can be also the use of the CPU power. So I hope that this simulation and this presentation satisfy your request about MATLAB and AWS, and I want to thank you for your patience and the time you give us to listen this brief presentation. Of course, we are very free to answer to your question here in the comment below or in the round table that will follow this presentation if you are following in this live. And you can also contact us in our emails. And okay, thank you.
Thank you. And if you want to contact us for some specific question, you can do it by Facebook, Instagram. So I suggest you to subscribe to our MATLAB Polymy channels. And also, of course, you can also write us an email. So have a nice day, and thank you.